Hi, I'm Dr. Jeffrey Annamarina from Bellissimo Plastic Surgery and MediSpa, and welcome to our Facebook Live event. And so today we're going to be talking to Pamela, one of our nurse injectors. And Pamela, I've been working together for a while now, and some of the stuff that we wanted to talk about tonight is some of the new stuff that has come around, the techniques that have changed. I find that the MediSpa has really taken on some revolutionary changes. It's very exciting, and Pamela's right on the cutting edge of all of that. And so she keeps us as a practice, her and Ashley, really up to date on the new techniques and what we can treat and how we can treat them. So I think it's really changed. And so welcome, Pamela. And
thank you.
So, and you know, it's nice for you to join and talk about this. It's something that you love to do, and it's something that you know, as part of the practice, it's a huge part of the practice. I mean, the reason for me to start a medical spa is as an adjunct to what I do. Not everything can be treated with surgery. And as I've often said, and many of the patients that might be listening, you know, surgery does not correct lines. And so, you know, a lot of times that's why we have a MediSpa, it's why we have devices such as lasers and the Virtue, which you might need. But that's, you know, Botox and dermal fillers. So let's go through that and explain some of that. But, you know, we were talking recently and then just a little bit earlier about how much dermal fillers have changed, your techniques, and also the amount of dermal fillers, the cross-linking, the length of durability. So, you know, it used to be, as we talked about, you know, basically every crevice that you had on the face, we just filled it. That kind of gave kind of a fuller look. So thinner patients had too full of a look, patients that have a little bit fuller face looked heavier. So that's all different now. So tell us about kind of how that's changed.
It has changed. I've been in the industry for approximately 12 years now, and I see changes coming daily. Whenever someone comes in for a consultation, my first thing is just asking them their concerns. And if their concerns are volume loss in the face, you know, like you said, we used to right away go towards the nasolabial fold, the marionette line, and fill that area. And that's no longer the case. We look at where the volume loss is coming from and try to create some volume in that area. So it can either be in the cheek area, the jaw line, just seeing where the volume is needed, and adding dermafillers in that area, depending on which one we would feel is best. And like I said, now it's probably a couple different kinds we can use in there. We have pretty, you know, a lot of options, and just seeing what's best for the patient and seeing what's gonna give us our best result.
So tell us that one of the questions we always get, and we always try to touch on that with every time that you and I talk on Facebook Live, is what's the difference between a neurotoxin such as Botox or Dysport and, you know, a dermal filler? What's the indication and how are they different?
So Botox is a neurotoxin, and it's used for if somebody has lines around the muscle, and usually the rule of thumb is here up is a neurotoxin, here down is a dermal filler. A neurotoxin, when you make an expression, smile, scowl.
I'm due.
The neurotoxin will go in there and relax that muscle and keep you from making such strong expressions and creating such harsh lines. Where a dermafiller is a hyaluronic acid gel, and it is in a form that it creates volume somewhere. So that's the difference between the two. A neurotoxin relaxes a muscle, is sold by the unit, and a dermafiller is sold by the syringe.
One of the questions that people ask is how do you know how many units of Botox or Dysport that you would need, you know?
When they come in, I, you know, ask them to make the facial expressions. And I think that's determined, you know, by the injector to, do they have etched in lines already? Are they pretty deep etched in lines? Are they superficial etched in lines? maybe someone doesn't have any lines yet, but they know just from their family history that they're going to create them there. So you would start light. And we start at an average amount, but then you can always increase it too if they feel like they're not getting the result that they need.
Right. And I think that's one of the things that we make sure patients realize. And it, you know, our philosophy is that we would rather treat you a little bit lighter because we don't want the frozen look. It's not a good look. It never has been. And so our goal is to never have a patient with a frozen face. So we would rather come have you come back and add a little bit more rather than
exactly.
a frozen face having to having it wait till it does, you know, till it's completely dissolved and then it starts animating again. So so anybody listening, I mean, that's sort of our philosophy of Bellissimo. And I still think that's the best way to go. But, you know, the neurotoxins have gone through a lot of changes. There's several more on the market now. There are some other ones that are supposedly waiting to come through the FDA that might be lasting longer. So, you know, on average, we see about 3 months of average for the neurotoxins, but there's some that are coming out that are supposed to be longer than that. So, which may be a good thing. The nice thing about the dermal fillers, you said, is hyaluronic acid. With different cross-linking, they last longer or they're more viscous so they can stack. So most of the time when patients come in and they're just starting to see that early sign of aging, and as we age, that face comes kind of down and forward and creating this fold. And as you mentioned before, the marionette lines, the jowling. So instead of filling those in, like as you said, we sort of build back here and pull it back. It simulates, you know, the same type of pull and lift that we do with facial surgery is to sort of re-establish that anatomy in the upwards, backwards movement. And so you do the same thing. So if somebody is now, say, you know, late 40s, early 50s, really not ready for surgery, they're not bad enough, or they're just not ready for surgery from on their own, kind of take us through how you would evaluate. They're just starting to get a little bit of the nasolabial folds. That fullness that used to be back here is now over here. What kind of products would you normally kind of use?
Yeah, when evaluating the client, you can see the pull. Like if they have a lot of pull, that determines how much product you would use as well. And showing them that in a mirror too is always really helpful to show them. The goal is always to make the patient look the same, just a younger version of themselves, not changing their look. So doing too much, you know, would change the look a little bit. And you don't want to do that. You just want to keep it nice and soft and keeping them looking like them. I would tend to use more of the longer lasting, deeper, thicker fillers in that area because you want to place it on the bone structure. So anywhere here, anywhere in the jawline. And a lot of times the first thing they do is when I show them that mirror, they're like, if I could do this, or if I could pull like this. So that's telling you right there where their volume loss is coming from. They're showing you, they're, you know, basically walking you right through what you're going to explain to them. And then the thinner fillers I would do, or medium fillers, if they need it after the fact in this area, you know, the medium fillers and the nasolabial folds around the chin area, paraorbital area, lips, and then the super, super fine fillers, you kind of layer on top of that to get the fine lines around the lips or even in the paraorbital area. Now, some people call them smoker lines, and a lot of times that's just hereditary. It's not, they may not even have ever been a smoker, but that will just soften up those lines.
Yeah. And so, and that's the thing is that, so those, the thicker ones that you were talking about are going to be deep along the bone. The sort of the medium fill is going to be sort of in that soft tissue. And then you can go right under the dermis, right under the skin lines. And so you can just stack those in areas that you need them to be filled. And so that, I mean, that's just amazing because we never really did that until just a few years ago. And, so, you know, I think the companies have really done a good job of bringing that to the forefront. What have we done in surgery and sort of mimic that, but doing it in a very non or minimally invasive fashion. So with the Voluma, which is the one that you use deep, you're getting about, what's the average lifespan or the...
It's approximately 2 years is the lifespan of it, depending on how the patient metabolizes. If they have a fast metabolism, they may, it may not last as long. So those deeper ones or the Voluma or the Restylane Lift, and then go more in the middle is Juvederms or regular Restylanes in that middle. But you also want to keep it flexible too. You don't want so much filler in their face that it, yes, it gives them that volume. But now most of the dermal fillers have a more flexible product that can kind of go around the mouth. So you don't see it. You should never, I always say, if you can see somebody's product, it's too much product.
Right. And I think that's what we've seen in the past. People started getting that mask-like appearance or almost, you know, I think what people don't realize is that even as we age, we still want contours. We still want to see a little bit of movement. And yes, when you move, when you smile, you want to see a little bit of pulling on the skin, because when you don't see that, it's not a natural look. And I think it causes people to notice it more because it's abnormal. It's not something we would expect to see. So when we see that, I mean, we've looked at that kind of patients that have come in for really to dissolve the product because it's too much. And so it's too heavy for their face. And so again, as we talked about with the Botox and Dysport, we want to have some movement in the forehead and in the glabella area and around the eyes. You want to have a little bit of movement so it doesn't look frozen. Same thing when you smile or around that buildup here. When you smile, if that filler is so tight and when you smile, it doesn't move, it's abnormal. So the flexibility now of some of the different fillers, you know, and the amazing thing, and that's the other thing that I wanted to kind of put out there, is that that's why if you're a patient looking for a place to do your dermal fillers, you have to be careful who's doing it, because you have to understand all of the products that are on the market, how they're cross-linked now. You have to have the sort of the chemistry behind it, because you need to know not only where to put them, but which ones to use in combination to which ones work and which ones don't work. And so if you don't do that, you're just sort of doing a trial and error. And, you know, if you're a patient, I mean, it's the trial and error is to your face. And if you have Voluma put in the wrong space, you know, and you got 2 years, you know, you know, and that being said, that's why, you know, the nice thing is why we use those kind of products and not some of the, so we use hyaluronic acid based products because we know we can control them and we can dissolve them. So we do have products that can, an enzyme that can dissolve them so that we can kind of eradicate them and start over. And we've had some patients coming in from other places that you've had to treat.
Yes.
And it's traumatic. I mean,
it is traumatic. It's very traumatic for the client.
So, but that's, I mean, that's sort of the new stuff in a nutshell, but it's, for you, it's amazing because, you know, we've been together long enough that, you know, where we used to do all the cross hatching and lines and things like that in those areas. And now to see it come completely different, it's a different philosophy, a different way to assess a patient. It's got to be so much more fulfilling for you because you're very creative. And so now you can kind of look at a patient sort of, you know, in a different light, sort of like the way that the surgeon looks at them and saying, okay, if I pull here and pull here, same thing with you. If I put in product and I'm pulling here and I'm pulling here, how amazing is that? Because you have so much more to deal with now and so much more to use. So I'm sure it's a lot more fun.
Yes, more products at our fingertips. It's a lot of fun.
The other thing that I have found in the past year, I think in at least on the surgical side, and I know on your side as well, because we've talked about it, we've passed patients back and forth together, is the lower jawline. I think, especially for the younger ladies, they've come in because they've seen themselves on profile, different photographs. And so that they want to have a very contoured lower jaw or mandible. And so they come in, they talk to me, there's some things that I can do surgically or, you know, with minimally invasive surgery. But that jawline now has become almost the hottest thing as lips were years ago. Everybody wanted that full look, you know. We'll talk about the lip flip in a few minutes, but tell us about that jawline. How do you sculpt that jawline? And again, are you seeing it as a younger crowd? Because that's what I'm seeing.
I am. I believe that there's a couple different reasons people come in and we end up using the jawline filler for them. One is if they have fullness here and their chin sits back a little bit. And I think a lot of these Zoom meetings and things like that are having people look at themselves and seeing that more and more. And they'll come in and they maybe haven't mentioned it, you know, the first few times they were in, or maybe the first few years they were in. Now all of a sudden they're like, you know, now that they're hearing about it, you know, what do you think? Do you think I'd be a good candidate for that? And doing that side profile on them will really show them how it can look. Now there's, it can, if you have a volume loss here and your chin sits back, you can build this out and back here to give them, like you said, that structured looking nice jawline. Or if they have excess under the chin and you want to bring that up a little bit, that's another way of pulling up, giving the jawline some structure. And then they can see their profile is underneath their chin doesn't look so full for them. So a couple things there, seeing bringing it out or just lifting it up a little bit.
Yeah, it's been, like I said, it's been one of the hottest things that patients want to talk about. And so the other thing, you know, you talked about the chin a couple of times. You know, years ago, it was always talk and a lot of chin implants being done. Mm-hmm. You know, we don't see that very often anymore. I don't have too many patients coming in asking for them. The ones that I do see, I mean, I've corrected a few that patients have had done elsewhere. The biggest problem with the chin implant, number one, is sometimes it's too big for the patient and it looks, makes mm-hmm. them look too bulky, but they have a tendency to slip on one side or, you know, get off balance. Mm-hmm. And so patients can feel them where they have, you know, it's just not a nice symmetrical chin anymore. So, you know, when we've talked to patients now, we're actually using dermal fillers. And I think mm-hmm. it's a better choice. It's softer and, you know, in some patients we can use fat grafting as well. And so, mm-hmm. and that works pretty well, but the chin's kind of a different structure because the below the skin, the tissue is very fibrous. It's stuck mm-hmm. to the bone pretty well. So do you find that's more of a challenge to put some dermal filler in there than say in the cheeks or in the lower jawline?
Yeah, for sure. But you can do less product too and kind of sculpt a little nicer too. And then sometimes I have them come back after a while because I feel like the filler gets in there, loosens it up a little bit, and then they can come back and then you can add to it and give it, you know, more of a structured look. So that's always an option.
So, and that's the amazing thing as well, because, you know, basically before you had to pick a small, medium or large chin implant. It's basically all you mm-hmm. had. And now you can actually, depending upon the patient's facial structure, you can, you know, use something a little deeper and something a little bit more superficial and stack it and, you know, and really sculpt out a nice chin for them. The mm-hmm. other nice thing about it is that the patient is awake when you're doing it, and they can sort of guide you to what they mm-hmm. want. When you put in a chin implant, they go to sleep, you do it, they wake up and, you know, it's swollen for a few weeks. They don't know, you know, so they don't know what's going to happen. And so they're in anticipation for several weeks before the swelling goes down enough where they can see what the results are. Now they're actually working with you to build the chin that they want.
Exactly.
It's amazing. The other thing that, you know, when you talk about the jawline, and I know that you've done this, some patients, not so much in women, but in men, but there are some women that have a thick masseter muscle, and that's mm-hmm. the muscle when you bite down that clenches your jaw. Some people can have an overdeveloped masseter muscle. So mm-hmm. in that case, you know, you can really use what you've been using is a little bit of Botox to mm-hmm. relax it, and then maybe some dermal fillers to help sculpt out the rest of the jawline. So again, you can be very creative and, you know, depending upon what the patient wants. So,
yes. And they'll usually tell me that too. They'll see that. And a lot of them have TMJ that goes along with that. But if that's usually an issue and you feel that masseter muscle, as soon as they bite down and it pops out and you can see it, a lot of them don't like that. So they want the face slimmer, but then the dermal filler will give you that structured look.
Yeah, that's pretty amazing. So the next thing is that patients want to know about is this, I don't know, it's relatively new, but talk about the lip flip.
Yeah, it's new all of a sudden, but we've been doing it for a long time. I think I've been doing it for about 8 to 10 years, but it's right. new now. I think it's a new thing on TikTok, but
it's got a name now.
It's got a name. And it's nice if you are not sure if you ever want dermal fillers or if you just want a little fullness of the upper lip. And it's usually just 2 units of Botox right in the 2 peaks of the lip to flip it back. And then it'll give a little fullness in the bottom. It occurs over a couple of days and it lasts maybe about 40 days, somewhere around there. But if somebody's just not sure if they really want lip filler, it's a great thing to lead them into it. Or to say, try this, see how you like this, just to get a little bit of that look, a little bit of that fullness, and to keep the upper lip flip back a little bit.
Yeah, and so again, when we talk about being careful, you know, this is why you use just a couple of units. You can always add more if you need it. But, you know, that muscle around the mouth, if you knock it out too much, now the lip is not working as properly. Right. Eating, drinking, and speaking can be a problem. But in those small little areas, and you get that nice little flip, do you combine it with a dermal filler for somebody who's had it, you know, and they like it, or they want, you know, you put some dermal fillers in, they want just a little bit more upturn?
I have done it. Yeah, I've combined them both. Do the filler first, and then I do the lip flip after. And it gives it a nice look, but usually you can get the way you inject the lip filler, you can almost peek that yourself and flip that back yourself with the filler. So sometimes it's not necessary, but some people like it and want it, and absolutely you can do it together.
So let's talk about the hardest thing that you and I tackle, and that's the lines around the mouth that are lovingly called smoker's lines. But again, it happens in a lot of people that do not smoke or have never smoked. We see it mostly in women. That tissue there is softer and a little bit thinner. You know, and again, because the muscle around the mouth is circular. So when you purse your lips, it creates, so lines that are created by a muscle are always perpendicular to the pull of the muscle. So that was what something I deem as the holy grail. It's nothing that I can fix surgically. The whole reason I bought my CO2 laser was, you know, when you do the facial rejuvenation surgery, they still had the lines. So, you know, we have tried everything in the past, from chemical peels and different types of lasers and things like that. But the whole reason I bought my CO2 laser was to help soften them. And I tell patients, we can soften, but we can't cure. So, you and I have worked together on some of this stuff. It is absolutely tough to do, but, you know, we've gone everywhere from a little bit of Botox, even some dermal fillers. And now with some of the newer dermal fillers, how do you tackle it now?
Depends on how deep they are, how many they have as to how I tackle them. How far they want to go. Do they really want to try just softening first with a little bit of Botox? Now, if they're super deep, that's really not going to do much. If they're a little deeper, a little more etched in, then I start with usually like a softer, thinner dermal filler that's more superficial, and just basically laying a little reservoir of it underneath there and letting it seep into those little lines. Doesn't last super long. But sometimes in combination too, if you do that with a little Botox, it does knock out that pooling of them pursing the combination of the two will, but the customer doesn't always like that either. You know, if you can't spit, if you can't suck on a straw, like they don't like those kind of feeling, how it makes it feel, where a derma filler will just make it feel normal.
Right. The Botox makes it feel a little bit heavier. So, yeah. I mean, I've been trying, and not just me, I mean, plastic surgeons have been trying it for years. We do facelifts. We take a little bit of fat, put a little bit of fat filling back in there, because that's what happens over time. As we age, we actually lose fat in our face. And that's what we've been talking about, is how you volumize. And there's lots of plastic surgeons that will just use fat for everything. And, you know, I think fat works great in some areas. I'm not wild about it, or as much as some of my colleagues use. But I think in that area, the problem is, it's such a mobile area. Whenever you put something in, whether it's a dermal filler, but especially for fat, fat is a living tissue. So it has to be in an area where it's going to reestablish a blood supply. So whenever we transfer fat, you know, any living tissue, especially most commonly a skin graft, and we immobilize that area for 2 weeks so that it doesn't move. So around the mouth, it's hard to tell somebody, don't move your mouth for 2 weeks, you know.
Exactly.
So sometimes you get some pretty decent fill and sometimes mm-hmm. you don't. And that's the problem with it, is it's the results are not consistent. But that's what we're trying to do as a team, is to try to rebuild that volume. So I think in combination with Ashley doing the Virtue device with the microneedle radio frequency, and I'm doing the CO2, that's helping to soften it. And then once we treat that, then putting in a lot of the dermal fillers and things like that, I think it's like, you know, there's no one good way of doing it, but I think you've got to use almost everything that you own in your practice to try to treat these things.
And exactly. Get right down to skincare. Yeah.
This is definitely a team approach from the right. esthetician, both the nurses and the surgeon all working together.
Yeah, use it all. With
the smallest area of the face.
Right.
You know, so right. it's frustrating. The other thing we were talking about with patients is that you and I have come up with this plan about a few years ago. What we are finding is that patients right after surgery or any time that their metabolism is high, we've been kind of holding off on dermal fillers and the neurotoxins because we find that it metabolizes quicker mm-hmm. than normal. So, you know, we want patients in the practice to get every day, every hour, every minute out of what you do.
What they're paying for, yeah.
So, you know, if you're having any type of surgery, especially if I'm doing any surgery, especially on the face or anything else, we really try to hold off at least a month, but anywhere between 4 and 6 weeks right. before we do anything. That way you get the most effect out of it. And, you know, we want to be as cost efficient with patients as possible. So I think one of the things that has been out for a while, patients are always asking about Kybella. And we use Kybella. We've had good success with it, but you know, it's sort of limited in what you can do with it. So talk to us about Kybella and what you use it for.
The most common place is underneath the chin area, where someone sees that they have some fat there, and you know, it bothers them every time they look in the mirror, every time they look in a rear view mirror, they see themselves and they see that. Any side profile in pictures. They do have to have some fat under there though. It can't be just skin. So that's why a consultation is really important to see, are they a good candidate for that? So it's literally just right in this area. And we wait 4 to 6 weeks in between each treatment to see how well it did, to see if they need another treatment after that. But we've had great success. Some people need 2 treatments. Some people need a lot more, but we work together and see how well it works for each person. We've used it other places. The little fat pad, like right in the bra pad area, front and back, I've used it. It has to be a small area. Now, a big area, it's really not cost effective and it doesn't do very well there. But a little patch above the belly button, I've used it there before too. Just a little... just probably a 2-inch area right above the belly button. Someone just had a little patch and took 2 treatments and it was gone. So just very small areas, it works really well.
And so what's the downtime mostly? Because patients want to know that as well.
There really isn't any downtime. I have them, after the treatment, I have them sit there for a few minutes and explain, you know, not to work out that night, that it might be a little tender to touch. But honestly, no one has really complained that it has created any issues other than a little bit of tenderness. They're swollen for a couple of weeks. Yeah, they're swollen for a couple of weeks. And then after that, it's where it was the day they come in. And then the 3 weeks to get you to the 6 weeks is where they see the progression.
What about men with shaving? You know, does it cause, not so much problem with shaving, but does it get a little bit numb because of the swelling? So they just
have to be careful. Usually I ask them if they could come in being clean shaved, so that way they don't even have to worry about it for, you know, a couple weeks, because it's going to feel a little funny and a little tender there, and like you said, somewhat a little numb to them.
Well, some of us are a little bit hairier than us. So. Yeah. if I waited 2 weeks, I might have a full beard.
You have a full beard.
So another question that somebody had written in, and we were talking about, we went over some of the questions that they asked, but there, and this is sort of kind of to sum up what we've talked about, but so this patient asks us, she has a very thin face and she's been losing weight and it keeps getting thinner. Is there some type of injectable to help me make the face fuller? So I'm sort of kind of ending with this one because I just kind of want you to sum up almost as, you know, talk about again, if this patient came to you, you know, in consultation, kind of walk her through if you were going to talk to her about, so this is somebody now who probably has some loss of volume in the cheeks, probably has some lines here, you know, the nasolabial folds, and she's otherwise a thin faced person to begin with. So we can't use a lot of volumizing with her, but kind of talk through what your game plan would be to build up the cheeks and everything and what products and kind of take her through how you would normally explain to them and kind of go through.
Yeah. So, explaining to them, showing them where the volume loss is coming from, stating that we want to put it back where they lost the volume from, and fill in the pool. If it's a lot of pool here, if it's a lot of pool here, some people get that separation here. So you want to make sure that you fill that separation. And it's basically just building it up a little bit. So we would talk about volume or lift in the cheek area. And a lot of times back here, I'll come and just put a little L-shaped right back here on the jawline because it pulls this back a little bit. So a lot of people see this. They'll talk about this all the time. This bothers me. So up and back on this side. Then I come back to say, okay, once we see what that pull does, and you don't ever want to see it. You just want to pull it back enough that it gives nice volume, takes away any separation here. And then we would come back in if they need something filler in the middle range of thickness to fill in anything else that they see around this area. Because sometimes, like you said, you can't get some of the finer lines by pulling back this way. They're still going to be there. But what can we do to soften this up now?
Yeah. And so, and again, the nice thing about it is that the patients are awake and you're talking to them and they have a mirror. And so again, they can help you create the look that they want. And knowing, you know, how, you know, what you have in your armamentarium that you can use to get them there. So it's really come to where it's you can really fine sculpt somebody's face now. And with some pretty good longevity. I mean, like you said, Voluma lasts a couple of years. Most of the other ones are lasting maybe 6 to 9 months, but you know, it really just depends. Some of the thinner ones are going to break down a little bit sooner. And the ones around the mouth. So if anybody is, or missed that part of the talk, anything around the mouth is going to wear off faster because it's such a mobile area. It's very difficult for anything to last a long time, where the cheeks are less mobile. So you can use a little bit heavier product there. So they will last longer. So, you know, depending upon what you need done, if it's mostly, and the more common things is rebuilding that cheek, you can get, you know, a good 18 months to 2 years out of it. So, you know, a lot of great things, a lot of exciting things that are going on, and there's new stuff on the horizon. And, you know, we do know that there are things in the pipeline. We're waiting for FDA approval for things coming out that might be a little bit more flexible, as you talked about before, so help somebody when they smile actually remain, you know, very fluid when they smile and more natural than what we have today. I think all these companies are very dynamic. They don't just put out the products and just ride them out. They're always looking to improve them. Yeah. And so we have that. We have the neurotoxins that are going to be lasting longer too coming out. So lots of great things. So, but I just wanted to thank you again for taking some time to explain that. It's the spa is very busy. And I think that to your credit and Ashley and Tara, I mean, you all three do such a great job of educating patients. And we want every patient to feel when they come in, it's not just to do the service, but to educate why we think this is the best way to do it. And all their concerns are addressed. And, you know, and you've always done that well. So I commend you on that. So, thank you again. And thank you for everybody who is watching. I hope we answer all the questions that you had for us tonight. And, but please feel free to ask questions and send in more questions. We can always get back and get Pamela back on the Facebook Live. So we will see you next time. And I hope everybody has a good rest of the day.
Okay.